And focus. All right, I have to use some words to get around the YouTube algorithm, like deleted, to talk about the passing of a human being, which admittedly sounds disrespectful, but it's just for the YouTube algorithm, though I kind of hate to use it. But anyway, click the links for Gab, Odyssey, BitChute, Discord, or Switch channel through crypto or through coffee. So the Baldwin Trump curse, the Hillary curse, actually feels like Hillary Clinton and her cronies, they have a huge body count behind them. I'm not sure if that's a curse so much as the Clintons just tying up loose ends. Like, yeah, I'm saying the Clintons are very, very bad people. The Trump curse seems more like she's shining a light on people who are just so eager to slip on banana peels to the point where a lot of people throw banana peels out in front of themselves so they can trip on them. And life in the simulation universe. Are we in a matrix? No, but I wish we were. Okay, so Alec Baldwin asks what it felt like to delete somebody, and now he knows. I'm going to do a lot of heavy assuming here, but I bet when the facts come out, I'll probably be pretty close. And if not, I'll own up to it. He pointed a .45 at the camera woman, the director of photography, pulled the trigger, fired it, and deleted her. The bullet passed through her and winged the director, hit him in the clavicle or something. First of all, how can this happen on a movie set? Well, imagine a revolver filmed from the front. You need to see the bullets in the cylinder so it looks like it's loaded. So what you can do is take the real cartridges, I'll call it the integrated cartridge, the cartridge and the bullet will refer to the projectile, the piece of lead coated in, sometimes in copper. You remove cartridge, you remove the projectile, the bullet, you pour the powder out, and then you pry out the primer, and then you shove the bullet back in the case, you load the cylinder, and it looks real, so when you film it from the front. But what if you didn't remove the primer, that initial little cap at the back of the back of the casing? Provides the initial spark to ignite the powder to cause the expanding gases. And what if you fired the thing with no powder in it, with just a primer? Well, the primer doesn't provide enough expanding gases to do any damage. It just provides just enough pressure to push the bullet into the barrel where it can kind of loosely get stuck there. Now you have an obstruction in the barrel. It's like death is just waiting. And then if you unload the cylinder and the property master looks at those six casings and he doesn't notice that, well, one's missing. If he doesn't notice that, he just dumps the casings and they load the blanks in the gun, which have a primer and a powder. Now, if you pull the trigger, that expanding gas will fire the bullet that was waiting in the barrel the whole time. And there's a lot of ways to make this safe. You have to have constant vigilance and due care when dealing with devices like this. It's like a knife is sharp. It's an inherently dangerous device. That's what it does. You just visually check for barrel obstructions. If it's automatic, you lock the slide back or you open the cylinder or revolver and you look out towards the muzzle. You can shine a little pen light from the receiver to the muzzle or use a cleaning rod to clear obstructions, make sure there's nothing in it. You should do this after target practice. Next, on set or anywhere else, you don't point the muzzle anywhere you don't want the bullet to go. Loaded or not, you never point it at a human being unless it's in self-defense. Movies are a bit different because they do have to point them at the camera for that, the point of view of, to look like you're the camera person. So they do have to do things like that. But you don't actually need a camera person behind the camera for those kind of scenes. You can just let the thing run, and when they're done with it, okay, put the Liberty device on the ground, we'll go back to the camera, and we'll examine the footage and see if we need to do it again, type of thing. You don't have a human on the wrong end of the muzzle when you don't need to do it. These aren't the old days where you had to crank the camera by hand. The thing with movies is, if you have a main actor behaving dangerously on set, in the real world, you're probably screwed. And there's a balance of power between, like, strong directors, weak directors, strong actors, weak actors, and the relative power and in Hollywood and that kind of thing. But we're talking like real world where you only have so much money to make movies and time is money. You try to do the best you can. You try to protect the actor from himself and others. But you're not going to fire the actor. You're stuck making the movie. I mean, unless the actor is like having a florid mental illness breakdown on set, then okay, fair enough. But anything short of that, the show pretty much must go on, because even the lowest of low-budget films, you're talking about millions of dollars, and you just don't have, like, if a director, you can't just shut down a film, or else, I mean, you're in the wrong industry if you don't. You really have to go with the idea that the show must go on almost no matter what. I mean, because these are the days of, like, a micro-budget film is $1 million, and it's like, well, you raise that money yourself, or you got some investors to raise it, and it's like, well, they want to see their, you know what I'm saying? Like, you just can't do this twice. You get one shot at raising a micro-budget film, and these are bigger budget films, but not huge budget films. And then with most actors, you give them the benefit of the doubt. But Baldwin has a history of violence wigging out at paparazzi, which, you know, they totally deserve it. But then he also wigged out at somebody for a parking space. It's like, dude, one, don't wig out at anyone for a parking space, because you can assume that everyone is carrying and insane and has less to lose than you. And if you're a Hollywood actor, you know, you're doing pretty well for yourself. You have a lot to lose. Don't mess with people who have nothing to lose, because you're going to catch a bullet. And that's, I mean, it's like if you're in anywhere in the United States, like you're always at risk of that. It's like somebody wants a parking space, you let them have it and you go on with your life. Because like you may be armed too, but the thing about two people being armed is you're not bulletproof. Anyway, he's got a history of violence, so I don't give him the benefit of the doubt. I can easily imagine him doing something stupid on this set. In this case, hitting two people. So what's the minimum we can speculate? He pointed the muzzle at two people and pulled the trigger, and there was a charge and a bullet that hit two people, passed through one, probably the neck, and hit the other guy in the shoulder or the clavicle, one mortally. And I'm going to guess he was not supposed to do that. Because, as I said, you don't need to be behind the camera when filming these scenes for this very reason. But anything can be possible. It could be the director's fault, the director of photography. They just told him to film it this way, and everyone assumed the barrel was clear. Well, now that I think about it, you don't want to be anywhere near the expanding, super hot, burning powder that's leaving the muzzle at probably 100,000 feet per second. Even the camera has a piece of plexiglass in front of the very expensive glass to film through to protect the glass from that burning hot debris, which will damage the lens. So it would be odd for a director to put himself and the director of photography at risk. Which sort of leads me to guess that Baldwin was not following directions when he pointed the muzzle at two people and pulled the trigger. Was he joking around, or was he angry? That's why I mentioned his violent past. And I don't mean that he loaded it and acted with the intent to do harm. I mean that he's the sort of guy, idiot, who doesn't like to be told what to do. Like, if you told him to keep his finger off the trigger and be muzzle safe, he would do something stupid. And you, if you don't know, if you're young, you don't know, maybe don't know the guys, these type of people I'm talking about, people who don't have a filter between their brain and the impulse. So if you tell them not to do something, they have this oppositional defiance disorder thing, where they will do something stupid to the point of like pointing a muzzle at somebody and pulling a trigger just to, because you told them not to. And this guy's almost 70 years old. It's like, if you know guys like this, people like this, men and women, you know what I'm talking about. There are people like this out there, and unfortunately, it's not a position where, oh, just don't hire Alec Baldwin. Well, it's like, well, he's the actor you could get, and he's the actor you can afford, and who would do the job reasonably. It's like, oh, yeah, that's it. It's like in the real world, you're forced to work with idiots. And idiots who have who have this like oppositional defiance disorder. And I'm doing a lot of heavy assuming here, but you know, we'll find out. And he does have a history of violence, which in this case, he did. He pointed it at two people and he fired it. And any way you slice that, that doesn't look good. Technically, if you wanted to go down the criminal law path, you've got the actus reus and the mens rea. He did the act that caused the harm. He did something you should never do. He pointed the muzzle at a person, unless you intend to fire it in self-defense. He actually committed the act, and he was the cause of harm. Was he intentional, reckless, or negligent? You know, in a perfect world, it would be decided before a jury. I can't imagine a director and director of photography telling an actor to point at them and fire, because that's just a suicide wish. It's just, that's not the risk a photographer, director of photography signs on. That's not the, there's people talk about legal, there's something called assumption of risk for different events. That's not something a director and photographer assume the risk of, to be shot on camera. You would simply get off away from the potential path. You get off set and just and film via remote, or just let that thing run. It's worth doing a couple of takes. It's just not worth being on the wrong end of a muzzle, which leads me back to Alec Baldwin pointing at two people and committing the act of pulling the trigger. It doesn't make sense that Baldwin was directed to do that. And if he did it under direction, it would still be an unreasonable act, because you just don't point a muzzle at a camera person. It's an inherently dangerous, unreasonable thing to do. But at least Baldwin could say that he was just following orders, which might mitigate, help explain his state of mind to, homicide without justification, mitigation, or excuse is usually going down the path of manslaughter or murder. But what if he wasn't following directions? Like I said, with the oppositional defiance disorder type of behavior, what if he was just angry and reckless? He's a guy with a history of violence and an inability to control his temper. Did he act with reckless disregard for the welfare of these two people? Who knows? Looking at him, judging him from his history? Yeah, probably. It's easy for me to say, but we'll find out. But this is Hollywood. The rules do not apply to Hollywood. As crazy as that sounds, it is what it is. It do what it do. Technically, this might be a manslaughter or a negligent homicide. I don't even know what state it was filmed in. If it was you or me doing this, a YouTube video, we would be in jail awaiting trial, and we're probably going to trial for something, unless we're a woman. In which case, it's case dismissed. If you're familiar with that YouTube case about the YouTuber influencers, husband and wife team, I think, or boyfriend girlfriend team, who were testing out a vest with a 50. And it's like, yeah, the 50 went right through the vest, because the vest is designed to stop, 9mm to 45. A 50 is something with, twice the muzzle velocity. It's not designed to stop that. Well, and really, why wouldn't you test the bulletproof vest on, just a pile of sandbags before you actually put a human being behind it? I looked at that video of the two people, and it was, judging from the conversations they had, I'm guessing they were both cognitively impaired, diminished capacity. How dumb were they? They were able to make YouTube videos. Little cell phone there. They were slower. There's this bell curve, right? And the people who are doing this video, it's like, kind of by definition, if you do a video where you're wearing a vest and you have somebody point a device at you, there's something wrong with you. I mean, and in this case, these people were, both of them were diminished capacity. Anyway, she got let off because women don't have agency. They have vaginas, apparently. Anyway, like, comment, subscribe. I'll see you guys all next episode.